emotionally or physically or mentally, whatever the case may be. They may be highly charged, or they may be extremely susceptible, or they may be in a situation where they can see things with their non-physical eyes. So that could explain people having visitations from loved ones. And this is on record where people have seen loved ones prior to or before they passed away have a visitation, or it could be a stranger that has a connection with another person without knowing it. So that could explain a lot of, you know, a lot of so-called ghosts or apparitions.
Now, Michael, since you've gone to the Monroe Institute and you've taken the courses with in remote viewing, is there a connection between an out-of-body experience and remote viewing?
There is a connection there, and that you have to, in order to be able to remote view, and of course, for your listeners who don't understand that, remote viewing is the modern terminology, Rob, for clairvoyance. And remote viewing is the inherent ability to perceive places, times, and remote in time and space, and to perceive people, places, and or things remote in time and space.
Right.
And then bring back information. So remote viewing, it's like watching a large television screen, or watching a large movie screen and perceiving the event, but you don't actually feel that you're there. When you have an OBE, you actually feel that you're there. So you can, and when you're remote viewing, you can't see your hands or your feet. When you're having an OBE, you can perceive what you believe to be your hands or your feet. So there's that difference there.
So when you're having an out-of-body experience, where do you go, Mike?
That's a good question too. In the beginning, Rob, I had, when I had the OBEs and I was able to induce them at will, I used to be stuck here in the physical, and I'd project into the second state, which is the non-physical, and I'd be there and I'd say, well, what's going on? Well, what is this all there is? And contrary to popular belief, there's no guide there to guide you or to take you where you want to go. So I'd be there. I would be just going to the sidewalk outside the house. I would go here, I would go there. And for years I did that. I want to go where other people said they were going, into the non-physical, other realms, other energy systems. So for several years I was stuck in the physical, and then something happened where all of a sudden I was able to project into another energy system, one where maybe people go to where they pass away. And so this is what happened to me, where I visited my stepfather, where I visited my father, where I visited friends who had passed on. And I automatically got very bored of the physical and always projected somewhere into the non-physical or other energy system.
All right. So is an out-of-body experience the same thing as a near-death experience, except in the case of an out-of-body experience, the person who is having the experience is in good health, and a near-death experience is when they actually have an out-of-body experience due to some illness or some trauma accident that they've had.
That's right, Rob. That's right. That's correct. If you have, for example, a car accident and you go to the windshield, you may have an incident where you roll on the ground, and then you look back and you realize that your body is half through the windshield, but you project it. That's a near-death experience. It's an experience usually brought on by a psychic, emotional, physical trauma that it'll force you to have an out-of-body experience. And usually that's not comfortable to have. So having an out-of-body experience, for example, when you're having an operation, there are thousands of recorded incidences, Rob, where people have had surgeries or anesthetic, and they find themselves having another body.
Right.
And the surgeons acknowledge this today. They do acknowledge that. They don't explain it, but they do acknowledge it. So that's an out-of-body experience. Near-death is where it's forcibly put to you, or you have a shock, whether physical or non-physical, that induces the OP. So this is not what I want people to have.
Right.
I want you and people to be able to bring it on at will. So, for example, either during or usually after, a trigger to initiate awareness while you're out of body. That's more comfortable, and you wouldn't want to have an NDE to have an OPE.
No, I guess not. I certainly understand that and appreciate that.
Yeah. I do have techniques, by the way, that have worked. So I'm a little bit of a renegade when it comes to the Monroe Institute, and I have techniques that I've shared with individuals that I can share with people that would help them to have either a bilocation or some sort of separation. So I do have a special CD on that called Astral Sound that I developed 21 years ago, and that I have on the market now. It's a very special CD.
So I guess another big difference between an out-of-body experience and a near-death experience is that when you're having an out-of-body experience, you're actually in control of the experience, if you know what you're doing. And with a near-death experience,
right.
You go to the light whether you want to go there or not.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. You may have a near-death experience and you may go to the light.
Mm-hmm.
And I personally, of all the experience I've had, by the way, I have never seen a light. So It could be that you only may get that in a near-death experience. But I have crossed what I believe to be the other side, which is known as Summerland or Winterland or other locales. And so you can go there. Since we're multidimensional, we still have that ability. You can do that.
Mike, when you're having your out-of-body experience, do your senses work? Can you smell? Can you hear? Can you touch? Can you feel if it's warm or cold? Or is it through basically the mind that this experience happens?
Yeah, people ask me that question often. During an out-of-body experience, you feel like you're actually there.
Mm-hmm.
And you may be able to feel certain textures, right? But you cannot hear sound. You cannot communicate or hear sound, right? Unless it's some other being or things happening on that level. During a remote viewing session,
mm-hmm.
you can actually pick up tangible sounds or intangibles, noise, sound, and or texture, right? But during the OBE, you're more intangible, so you cannot hear anything. If there's an explosion, I've gone to places where there's large explosions or volcanic eruptions, and
mm-hmm.
I cannot hear it. But I could feel the molten lava traveling through, but I could not feel the heat, for example, or go through water. You can feel the water, but you cannot feel the wetness.
Right.
Or just the texture, but you cannot actually feel it. That's about the extent that I've perceived.
Michael, you and I have to take our news break at the bottom of the hour. Please stand by. Great having you back on the show, my friend. It's been too long.
Thank you.
It's been way too long.
Yes, it has.
ExoNation, Michael Telstarr is my guest this hour. He is a supernatural entertainer. He's a paranormalist. And he's a remote viewer, and he's also one heck of a nice guy. His website is www.michaeltelstarr.com. That's michaeltelstarr.com. We've got to take our news break now. You'll be joining your local affiliates, and we'll be back at 33 minutes past the hour. My name is Rob McConnell. This is The X-Zone. A place where people dare to believe and dare to be heard. Monday through Friday from 10 p.m. Eastern until 2 a.m. Eastern. Live and around the world. Right here from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Michael Telstarr and I return. Don't go away. Are you considering calling a psychic to read your situation? Then consider David Champion, a psychic medium for more than 20 years with thousands of readings under his belt. David Champion will make you feel comfortable. He has proven to be honest and accurate. He's a straight shooter. There's no guesswork. What he sees is what you get. While he is a medium, most of the calls focus on relationships, not only love, but work, school, neighbors, and more. Need help with finding a job and preparing for the interview? Are you dealing with people who are obstacles in your path? For more information, go to davidchampion.com, $1.50 per minute, paid by credit card, with a minimum of 30 minutes. For your reading with David Champion, call 1-877-702-8598. That's 1-877-702-8598. Now you can dial in to listen to the X-Zone Radio Show from anywhere in the world with Rob McConnell 24/7, 365 by dialing 213-401-0080. That's 213-401-0080. If you have a mobile phone or landline, the X-Zone Radio Show with Rob McConnell is now at your beck and call at 213-401-0080. That's 213-401-0080, 24/7, 365.
365.
You're listening to the X-Zone Radio Show, live and around the world on the Telstarr Radio Network.
X-Zone Broadcast Network.
UK High Definition Radio.
Euro High Definition Radio.
And Star Cable. Our toll-free telephone number worldwide is 1-800-610-7035.
Our email address, xzone@xzoneradiotv.com.
On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com.
And our website,
www.xzoneradiotv.com.
Welcome back to the X-Zone, everyone. Michael Telstarr is my special guest this hour. www.michaeltelstarr.com. Michael, when you do remote viewing, do you go into the future? Do you go back into the past?
That's a good question. I was in the Master's Extended Remote Viewing. That's exactly what we were taught to do. And everybody would ask, well, how do I go into the past? How do I remote view the past? How do I remote view the future? You can do it. And it's a matter of just simply knowing how to initiate the trigger to go into the past or to the future. So it's just a matter of utilizing your intent. But you can't do it exactly at the moment. So, for example, I cannot remote view, say, next Friday's Lotto Max numbers.
Right.
Otherwise, I would have done it a long time ago. But I may be able to remote view within a week or a month. But exact circumstances are extremely difficult to do. Not impossible, just extremely difficult to do.
Now, Michael, when it comes to remote viewing, is there any possibility that because you go into the future that you bring back with you some information that could actually change the future or alter time as we know it?
Well, I have had experiences through the OBE and remote viewing, where I have remote view of the future, what I refer to as the future, and it'll be mentioned in my book coming out. And I've gone 50 years, 100 years, 150, 250 years. Some of the information you get, doesn't matter what you get, will not change the future. Your actions will not change it. However, if your perception of the future changes, and it's optimistic, then you can share this information with people, and it can actually change some circumstances that will occur. So free will is in place, but it seems that there is some sort of predetermined future because there are millions of people thinking about this possibility, so it happens, but it can be changed.
How do you protect yourself when you go and do an out-of-body adventure, or if you're remote viewing that you actually do come back to this physical body? Is there any chance that you may not?
Well, so far, I have been able to come back. Once you learn how to leave, the trick is staying out and not worrying about coming back. But there have been instances where I have been out of body and the experience was so unpleasant that I wanted to come back into the physical, and I could not do it. And I don't understand why I could not. But going in the wrong body is extremely rare if it happens at all. Otherwise, you would be waking up in someone else's body, or I'd be waking up in Bill Gates' body, fighting with 2,000 other people to take over his body. That wouldn't be so bad, would it? But on the other hand, That was the difficulty. Everyone has a peculiar brainwave signature, Rob, and this is.